Hey everybody, it's Sean. Today's video is called Design Balance. And design balance, for the purpose of our video today, is sort of about, I guess, a little bit of a design philosophy, which is you can kind of divide your graphic design work into sort of two categories. One category is your creative decisions. You decide something looks cool, you do something for the effect, for the tone, for the manner. And then there's other things that you do, which are basically mathematics, you know, just measurements, how far from one thing is the next thing, what kind of space between things do you give, how large are your important elements, and then how much smaller does the less important elements get, by how much, all that kind of stuff. So I thought it would be a good exercise to possibly do a bit of a quick design and then talk about the parts of the graphic design process that aren't necessarily creative, but they help to make your layouts look that much better. That's sort of the point. And I think you'll see what I'm getting at once we go through this. So, design balance. What I've done here, let me just go to 100%, so you can kind of see this as you would see it in a browser, theoretically. So that white space around the edge is just sort of nothing, but this would be a web page. And I've given myself this fake band that I've made up. Maya and the Funk Tones. So this girl's got her band, and you know, theoretically she's a funky sort of soul singer or whatever she is. So I just made all this up, obviously, and the website is 1200 pixels wide, and that's kind of beside the point, but I'll get to all that stuff. So you know, this is the official website. And as you move down the page, you see that there's a new release. There's some album that they've just released, and here's a bit of information about it, obviously all fake. And here are a couple of reviews, and oh, look, I can get it on iTunes. And on the right side, you have a standard sidebar, although there's nothing that indicates a sidebar begins and ends, but we'll get to that as well. And I've just put the navigation on the side. And you'll see in the lapse time design work that I fumbled with a couple of different menus until I sort of landed here. But the idea was to keep it simple. And I've got a little bit of a navigation there for if playing the music. If you come to the website, maybe you can play the most recent track and you can stop it, pause it, go to the next. And whatever the band might want to give you for free is what that would be all about. Social media icons over here are pretty self-explanatory. A little bit of metadata about the album itself, the release date, how many downloads, how many shares, how many likes, and all that fun stuff. And then there's a description with a couple of reviews. Their best work to date. Maya's voice is elemental and funky, and the grooves are solid. You definitely should hear this one. John Smith, Music Magazine Weekly, whoever that is. I can click on here, go read the rest of the review if I want. Here's another one. There could be three reviews. There could be four or five. It doesn't matter. This is pretty clear navigation up here. I mean, biography, discography, photography, bookings, tours, and news. You sort of get what you want here. I didn't go into an elaborate sidebar with, you know, latest tweets, latest news, but I could have done that. I just thought this maybe was more interesting. Maybe what the band does is they offer you a couple of highlights. So you've got to search for the other information, so you kind of look for what you want. But maybe in this case, there's a couple of nice, big, fat bars down here. One of them just says, Maya talks to late night show host about her life as a young musician. Watch the video. So this is obviously some kind of an interview that she's done. And over here, we've got some live tweets that are coming from Twitter. Anyone who mentions them in a tweet, this is being picked up. But you get the idea that there would be something here coming in from social media live. You could reply to it, retweet it, or favorite if you wanted to. Very simple footer. Contact the webmaster, terms, download, no legal stuff, copyrights, and who the digital design was, which is my company right there. But there's no website there yet, so if you go, you'll just sort of get nothing, but there will be soon. It's a new company. So anyway, as of the time this video was made, of course. So anyway, here's this website design that I've done. So I'm not sort of pitching this to you as this is a graphic design solution, that's great, but I wanted to give myself something to work with so I could talk about the design principles. So I've already made my decisions, obviously. I've gone through and, you know, this black background, this moody photography, and, you know, nice bold type and very bold graphics and big blocky things. And you know, fat navigation and this cool little player, has, you know, obviously these things are creative choices that I made, and they contribute to the design, obviously. But there's something else that contributes to the design as well. And I'll make an argument for this, that it's not a great graphic design job because it's obviously all fake. However, what is working for it is a sense of graphic balance. There's elements on the page that all sit well together, and I'm going to show you what I did to get that. So I'm going to turn on my grid. And so once again, I've done this at 1200 pixels wide, and this is a 100 pixel division grid. So each one of these larger blocks is 100 pixels. And so the halfway mark here, you can see I didn't really do a one-third, two-thirds thing so much. I did in the body where the new release is and the sidebar. However, the top panel up here and this bottom two panels, these are splitting the website half and half. So I'm actually using two different grids here, which again is perfectly fine. So if I go in a little bit closer, I want to show you what I've sort of done. Actually, let's start at the top here. So this is kind of where you can see this line here where my cursor is and where the bottom of this type is. Now, never mind the Y that it dips below. That's a creative choice. But basically, the font lands on this one grid line. One block of this grid is what I use to divide elements that are related to one another. So as I went through the design, I sort of figured out this math as I went along. And you'll see in the lapse time all the different moving things around that I did. It took a while to kind of just figure out where these things wanted to sit, but this is where I ended up. And this number is significant, as I will show you in a moment. So this one block here of space separates the visual banner at the top from official website. Now, beneath official website, where the bottom of this type ends, I have one, two, three blocks. And then the title for my most recent bit of content, new release, Soul Candy is the name of this album that I've faked up. So there's three blocks that divide this official website from this title, new release. Now, beneath this title to the body copy, there is one block. One block divides the image from the text and the image from the title. Now, three blocks here separate the side of my container with my left edge of content. And I've got one block that separates the iTunes icon from the album, and one block again from the metadata, and so on. Now you'll see that I've actually made a mistake here, that I've separated these with two blocks, and I'm actually going to fix that mistake right now. It's funny, as I was recording this, you know why? Because I was counting three blocks from my social media buttons, but I didn't count three blocks from this content. So I'm actually going to fix this right now and move it down to three. One, two, three. I'm going to move this down to three, which means that my black content block should actually come down about there, just to make that up. So that's interesting, actually. As I was going through it the first time, I didn't notice that because I was on this side paying attention. So anyway, but actually this is a very good demonstration of why I do this. So basically now I can go back and check my math as I'm designing, and I can say, okay, hey, I've got this number that helps me now. So the decision to move this block down from this type block had nothing to do with creative. I didn't have to think about that creatively. I simply had to say, I have something in my design which tells me that three blocks divide two content areas from one another. Now, within this frame here, I've got one block of separation above and below my type. And similarly, I've got one block of separation above and below my type. Three blocks that separate these two panels from the footer text. And so overall, when I back up, hide my grid, and just zoom into 100%, actually now you see that looks more balanced. And it's funny that I didn't notice that before. But there you go. And so within the sidebar now, actually, I guess I shouldn't have turned the grids off quite yet, but you get the idea that now within the navigation panel with this little music player and the social media, there's one block that separates these guys from this menu. And then I've used two blocks to separate these. This type dipped down into this block. So I used one full block to separate them. And sometimes you'll make decisions like that. You'll sort of look at the math and kind of go, okay, well, I have to adjust in this one case. But the very topmost edge of my type and the very bottommost edge of my music player is one block of separation and one full block of separation here. So with my grid turned back off and just looking at the design view, I just wanted you to see that this page, while very graphic and while very nicely designed, I think this works well as a web design. I think it works well that everything is clear and easy to follow what this navigation. You can pretty much imagine where you're going to go when you see these things. And I didn't design everything full out because I wanted to talk mostly about these measurements. But it wasn't really creative decision making that brought this page together. What brought it together was essentially the math. So the purpose of showing you this design exercise was simply to say that not everything is a big creative decision, because sometimes you get into your layout and you begin to second guess why you're doing something. Why did I move this down here? Should I move it up higher? Should it be bigger? Should it be smaller? And these are all things that you'll struggle with as you design. I still struggle with those things today, and so do my colleagues, people that I've worked with who are in the business as long as I am and some longer. You struggle with these things. That is the design process. And there's magic to be had and you know, gold to be found as you do these things. And math doesn't always do it, but creative doesn't always do it either. Sometimes it's a combination of the two things. And you'll just build a grid or you'll work with some design concept that will just elevate your work. And when you know why it's doing that, like in this case, achieving balance through just paying attention to elements and their relationship one to the other, how far away are things? Well, I didn't have to think about how far away they were. I simply had to measure how far away they would be. And because I did it the same measurement everywhere, it's always one block, and then three blocks, one block, three blocks, and so on, then within each of these graphic areas, I could be creative and freeform. I could figure out a way to crop this image just so it was kind of cool, and I could figure out a way to crop her image so she looked more intense. And, you know, this is not a great font, not a great logo, but I was able to sort of, you know, dip it underneath this line and be a little bit more fanciful with the design elements within my work, because I knew that the math was holding it all together. And I think that that's actually kind of an encouraging thing, because sometimes it gets stressful to always try to find the cool, creative way to do something, when sometimes your cool, creative idea is already there. All you need to do now is measure everything and get it all to fit. So anyway, I wanted to give you that to think about and look at this, agree or disagree, like or dislike. Please feel free to comment and give your point of view if it's different from mine, but hopefully this helped you to see things a little bit of a different way. And I've, of course, included the lapse time design work with some very new, interesting YouTube music that I found. It turns out that if you have a channel on YouTube, YouTube actually offers you some free tracks that you can use exclusively with your YouTube videos. You can't sell them to somebody else or you can't distribute them, but if you have a YouTube channel and you make a YouTube video that you create, your own content, they allow you to use these tracks. And they're very cool, and I'll put a link to them in the description. And if you make YouTube videos, check them out. I thought that was kind of a nice thing. So anyway, the lapse time design is coming up, and I hope you enjoy it. So check it out and talk to you soon. Take care.